So as mentioned, my name's Arun. I work at Quizlet. I am one of the Android developers, so all the Android stuff that goes on there is mainly my fault. So yeah, today I'm gonna talk about a specific feature. So you heard a lot of great stuff from Adam, generally on a lot of design tools, design tricks, design issues that people run into kind of across the board, and we've run into pretty much all those issues, although we use ActionBar Sherlock, but we've needed to be compatible for a while, so we use it, it does work. But nonetheless, so today I wanted to go a little, you know, you've heard that overarching talk, and I'd like to go into something very specific, which is how we built a very specific feature and certain issues that we ran into. It's going to be, you know, pretty Android intensive, so if there are any questions that anybody has at any point, please feel free to stop me. If there are any things that I'm saying, if I talk too fast, you know, please feel free to stop me, and I'm happy to explain more in depth. So with that, here we go. How Quizlet built create set. To begin with, who actually knows what Quizlet is? Not bad. All right. So for those of you who don't know what Quizlet is, kind of our mission is to build great learning tools that can inspire and empower every student on the planet. Sounds really cool, right? So what we do is we build online study tools. That's like online flashcards, in-class games, tools for teachers, ways for people to study their content. It's all user-generated content, and that's a huge thing for us. And everything is, and most things are free, and we're constantly improving, and that's a big thing for us. We believe that you should be able to have access to really high-quality study tools for free, because that's how much most teachers and students can actually afford. There are a couple at these really nice places and stuff, but anyway. So just to give you a sense of scale, like KeepSafe is huge, we're also got a decent reach. We're about 30 million unique visitors a month. We are a top 75 website by traffic in the US, according to Quantcast. We're about 25% of all American high school students use Quizlet every month. And our whole thing is we have learners from all over the world. We have learners from pretty much every country. I was on our feedback center yesterday and I got an email from some guy from Kazakhstan. I was like, nice, someone from Kazakhstan's using my app. I didn't even know that. So just to give you a quick sense now, we're here to talk about Android. So just a quick sense of our app, what it is, what it looks like, what we do. So you come here and you log in and you get our feed, right? This is your feed, which kind of shows you the different study sets that you have. So there are two ways that you get study sets into here. One is by going to our search and searching for something and saying, I want to study irregular French verbs, and we'll give you, you know, the million sets that we have on irregular French verbs, and you can pick something. The other option is you can create your own content, either on the web, on the iOS app, or on the Android app, and I'll talk about that more in a moment since that's going to be the rest of the talk. Once you click on one of these items in your feed, it kind of shows you a set page. We call it a set. These are study sets. So the idea is that basically these are sets of content that you're studying, and generally the model that we follow is some kind of term and some kind of definition. You can have images and other things, but basically think about, you know, these study sets as, if you will, sets of flashcards where you have terms, you have definitions. We have three different study modes: flashcards, learn, and match. Not to go into too much detail about them, but basically flashcards, pretty self-explanatory. Flashcards, learn is a way to basically, we think it's a really effective learning mechanism whereby we ask you questions on your content, such as what is the capital of California, and you have to type in the answer. If you get it right, you know, great. If you get it wrong, we'll ask you it again. Try and make sure that you really learn it effectively. Lastly, we have match, which is a matching game. Term, definition, match them. You get the high score, all your friends are jealous, that's how it works. Now, the focus of today's talk, create set. So what we did here is we said, okay, we need to be able to create content on the Android app. Now this became a surprising challenge because as we looked around, there aren't that many apps that allow you to do the kind of stuff that we were trying to do, and I'll get to that more in a moment. But the basic idea was these were kind of what we were looking at. You know, you come to the screen, you have a side for terms, side for definitions. You should be able to fill them in, add more, remove. You know, here's kind of one in progress. That's what we were thinking. So this seems pretty straightforward, right? Make a list view, add some edit text in there, write some, you know, terms and definitions, hit save, everyone's happy, right? Not exactly. So as we started building this, we learned that basically everything we wanted to do just should not work. I don't know how many of you have actually tried to create content on device, unstructured content, that is, where it's not like a photo or something, but rather it's something that we don't know what it's going to look like, we don't know what language it's going to be in, we don't know how long it's going to be. If you have actually tried to do that, it gets surprisingly challenging. And I'm going to specifically pick on EditTexts and ListViews, because that's a very specific thing that a lot of people have seen problems with. So we start building all these EditTexts in these ListViews, and we start running into problems. So, you know, I Google some stuff, and Stack Overflow, of course, says, you know, first, Android ListView with EditTexts loses focus when keyboard displayed. Okay, you're going to have all these kind of problems, right? The more I continue looking, you then get to, you know, other comments on Stack Overflow, like, after unsuccessfully trying to create an interface with EditTexts inside of a ListView, all I can say is, don't. So that was the next. And then you get to posts as you go further on that are just things like this: buggy ListView makes me sad. And I got to that Stack Overflow post. You can look at these all. These are all just quotes from Stack Overflow, and I was like, all right. People are clearly sad about this, and everyone's basic advice was don't do this. But did we stop? Of course not. Why? Because we're crazy. So we said, no, this is what we want it to look like, because that's what we said we were going to make it look like. How do we do that? So I'm going to highlight some of the specific issues we ran into, and you'll probably see some parallels to what you heard in Adam's talk. But some things that I'm going to talk about, so touches and gestures. We wanted to do a lot of different kinds of touches and gestures. We wanted to do long presses and swipes and scrolls, and you soon realize that there aren't that many gestures and touches that you can do, but we wanted to do a lot of them. So that was one issue. Keyboard and sizing things. If we had another talk, I think we could make one called Why Samsung Why, another one called Why HTC Why, another called Why Sony Why. I think every single one of them has their own things that they like to do, especially when you look at keyboards and resizing your screen, things like that. Another issue that we ran into, and kind of the last one I'll really focus on today, are cursors, where cursors just have all kinds of surprising bugs in Android that you wouldn't really expect. And then kind of themes that will kind of be running throughout that I'm not going to highlight specifically are things like focus. When you have, you know, your focus is in a cell, you scroll somewhere, oh, all of a sudden your focus jumped because of cell recycling issues or something like that. Cell recycling in general was a big issue that we ran into that most people run into probably in a lot of scenarios. And editing our own data source, which I think is something particularly interesting. So if you think about say, what are the majority of apps people use? A lot of them are read-only apps, right? News apps, things like that. You're not actually editing your data source. You're viewing something that you're pulling in data from somewhere else. Or a lot of apps, you know, maybe you're editing your data source here and then actually view that data on the next screen. But here, we are dealing with data that's in memory, that's in our database on the phone, that's on the network, and we need to keep all of that kind of up to date and, as we're viewing our data, actually manipulating that data. But like I said, the first three are kind of what I'm going to more specifically touch on. And just kind of talk you through the problems that we face and how we solve them. And maybe you have more awesome ideas, which I'd love to hear. So touches. So there are two things I'd say to touches, which are what kind of touches you want and where you want to make the touches. So the touches we wanted to do, we showed up, we're like, okay. Again, the model is kind of a term definition kind of thing. So we said we want to do delete, maybe a swipe to delete or a long press to delete. That seems like a cool idea. You think about Gmail, you swipe to delete. It's really nice, really sexy. That's the kind of thing we want to do. Undo, something else that we want to do. Once you swipe to delete or long press to delete, the first thing you want to do is undo that because that's how everybody thinks. So we need to build in an undo functionality. So we started doing this. We built swipe to delete, we built some long press stuff, and it was really cool. And then we got to a point where we realized we couldn't do a lot of the things that we needed to do. By that I mean dragging your cursor around in a text field, for example, because the moment you have more than two words, you want to go back and edit things. Scrolling within a cell, same motion, though often it's a different intention, right? But actually scrolling within a cell on Android. Scrolling within the list view, so if you actually want to scroll within your whole view to go back to previous terms. Selecting text, obvious for cut, copy, things like that. And long press to paste. I specify long press because that's the Android default. You long press, you paste. These were all things we wanted to do. If we had to do all these with touches, I don't know how many touches and gestures are there, but I don't think they're enough to do all of these things. So we kind of had to prioritize, okay, what do we really need to do? And we came to the conclusion that these are the things we need to do, so this is what we're actually going to implement. And we'll come back to the other stuff. The next question for touches are where? Where do you touch? So you can touch on the list view, you know, right there on the list view. You can touch on the row, right there on the row. You can touch on the edit text, right there on the edit text. So there are three arrows there if you can't see, which you probably can't because they're overlaid. Point being, of course, that you can touch in the same place and have multiple intentions. So I think the main things that we ended up concluding were we had to deal with descendant focusability and row focusability slash highlighting of rows. So the basic idea is there. So when I'm talking about edit text, I mean one of these specific edit texts. Talk about row, I'm talking about, of course, the row itself. When I'm talking about the list view, I mean the whole list view. So when we realized that we have to deal with descendant focusability, that's a property that often you see in XML or you can set dynamically on a view, and basically deciding, hey, when I touch something, what is the user probably intending? And how do we figure that out? We brought in users and had them play with the app. And we kind of got to the point of, okay, what kind of touches and what kind of areas and what kind of motions have what kind of intention? And based on that, we could decide, you know, who should get the touch at which point? Which element, which view should actually get the touch at which point? So one example would be, in general, if you touch on an edit text, you want to edit that edit text. But if you touch and start scrolling, we actually realized you don't want to deal with that edit text. You're actually trying to scroll through the list view. So at that time, you can say, hey, turn off the focusability from my edit text and from my row, because that's not what I want to deal with. I want to deal with the list view, and that's what should have the focus. So that's a broad idea, but the concept was make sure that you set descendant focusability in the correct way, and making sure that you decide who should get the focus at what times. So that was kind of our takeaways from that. Then we come back to delete and undo. Well, what are we going to do with these guys now? So we decide, all right, let's make delete have its own little remove button right here. And the idea being, okay, if you click the remove button, you can actually delete a row, but now you want to do undo. Well, we found that people were adding content much more than they were removing content. And when they were removing content, they they really had to make sure that this is what they wanted to do. So we decided to make a popover on top of the top row of what you were looking at right now, which just lasts for a couple seconds. And it was, hey, here we are, we're above everything else. If you touch this, it will take priority. And if you don't want that popover there, it disappears in a couple seconds. And so that seemed like a reasonable solution. And that's what we went along with. And after bringing in more user testers, we came to the conclusion that these are kind of the ways that people are intuitively expecting the touches and the gestures to work. So that made us really happy. And that was kind of the solution we came up with. Next topic to cover, keyboards. We start with a screen like this. You click an edit text. You want the keyboard to pop up. That seems super straightforward, right? What could possibly go wrong? Nothing. It's the talk's over. That's it. No, just kidding. Everything could go wrong. So the big thing about keyboards is, for those of my Android developers here, you know basically the two things that you use are adjust pan or adjust resize that you can set in your manifest or set dynamically if you feel like it, but you probably shouldn't. There are other things you can use, but these are kind of the two overarching ones, and the other ones are similar. So we started thinking, oh, maybe we should use adjust pan. And the reason we didn't want to use adjust resize initially is because adjust resize will actually redraw the views. What happens when you redraw the views? You lose the focus, you lose maybe colors that you had set. We have numbers at the bottom of the screen, and those will get all off. So we said, there's lots of things that could go wrong there. So we said, let's go with adjust pan. But if you remember back here, we have this top and we have this bottom. And if you click on adjust pan, obviously the keyboard's gonna cover the bottom row, unless you click some edit text at the bottom, in which case the top of the screen pushes off. So that's clearly not a viable option for the main reasons of we need the bottom and we need the top. So we say, okay, I guess adjust resize is what we're gonna do. So we went about doing adjust resize, and what we said is, okay, we want to still save your states when the keyboard's coming up and things like that. So we said, let's override on measure. In views, you have the on measure method, which gets called all the time. And so we can say, OK, on measure, if the screen size is changing drastically, probably it's a keyboard change. So what we should do is save your cursor position and save the field you're in and save the row you're in and save all kinds of state. And then when the on measure is finished, plop all the stuff back in. That works great. Except, of course, for all the other kinds of keyboards that are out there. So the moment you start looking at other keyboards, both from different manufacturers as well as, of course, in different languages, things get really hairy. So the Japanese keyboard is where I spent a lot of my time, and it really caused me a lot of pain. I don't know Japanese, which was also made things more difficult. But basically, we did this on measure thing, and then we realized, so take Japanese as an example. When you click a character in Japanese, this bar pops up. And that bar can be variable heights. And so what we were doing is we were saying, okay, we have this on measure thing, and it re-puts the focus there. The problem is that, not that the cursor needs to be in the same place, but you guys can't really see this probably, but this is actually, this character in Japanese is highlighted in purple. And the point being, Japanese keyboards often work where it's not just character by character you click. You click multiple characters until you finish your word. Then from this dropdown, you need to click something. So it wasn't just where the focus was, but it had to remember what were the last characters that were part of these words. So we got to a point where we're like, okay, if we start making more and more hacks and overriding other things, it's going to be a bad idea. So we came to actually a relatively simple conclusion of don't rebuild the view if possible. So what happens is you have a keyboard that's a screen that's, you know, taking up, you have a view that's taking up the full screen. You open the keyboard, now you have to redraw the view to be much smaller than that. Well, when it redraws the view, it doesn't actually go through the whole process of doing the on pause, on destroy, everything like that. What it does is it basically, in a list view with an adapter, this is very specific to list views that are using adapters, you actually basically try and reset all the data that's within this adapter. So what we said is, well, when you get to the adapter and you call the getView method from the adapter, don't actually go about and reset everything. Say, hey, do I know what my term is? The term is the model that's, you know, behind the items in the adapter. Say, hey, if my term that's already in this item view is the same term that I'm about to try and put into it, then don't bother doing that because you already have it, and just return and call it a day and don't worry about it. And that simple trick actually allowed us to get rid of all of our hacks that we had on there. And so the conclusion was, don't rebuild the view if possible. And 99% of the time, we didn't have to actually rebuild the view. And in that 1% of the time we did, maybe your cursor lost focus and then came right back, in which case, everybody was still happy. So that was kind of the main solution for keyboards. But there are all kinds of nuances that until you really are messing with them, you don't often realize. The last thing I want to talk about real quick are cursor issues. So we had 12 issues in GitHub when I searched for the word cursors, and I'm sure there were way more. I could give a whole talk just on cursors, but that's not too exciting, because how exciting are cursors? The whole problem you see with cursors are cursors have all kinds of issues. When you start dealing with cursors on Android, in general, they should make logical sense and work as you expect. When you click on a thing, it pops up there, and when you click off of it, it goes away. But there are a lot of weird issues with different versions of Android and different makes of it, where sometimes the weights of the actual cursor may change. Sometimes you click an edit text, and you click another text, and you click another edit text, and then all of a sudden you have three cursors on the screen. You click on an edit text, and then the cursor is just invisible, even though you can type and it's there. And then, of course, there's cell recycling issues, which is, you know, you have a cursor here, and you scroll through, and all of a sudden your cursor's over there. So we started writing all kinds of hacks, and I could go on for days about them, but what ended up being pretty interesting is we stopped for a second. We said, okay, myself and our other Android developer, we sat down and we were like, wait, so what are we trying to do? And our conclusion was, well, when you get off of a cell, when you stop focusing on a cell, we want to remove the cursor. And then when you focus on a cell, we want to put the cursor there. I know that may be complicated. I'm going to say that again. When you leave the cell, remove the cursor. When you re-enter the cell, put the cursor back in. And so we were like, wait, what if we just do that? So we overrode the views on focus change method and said, if not has focus, then remove cursor, set cursor to invisible. And if has focus, remove whatever cursors you thought you had and put in a cursor. And just like that, all of our cursor issues were solved. And you can go on Stack Overflow and see for days cursor issues all related to this. If you simply override the onFocus change method to do these couple things, you've basically solved all of your cursor issues. So just to go over again what we talked about. Touches and gestures. You want to do a lot of things. Pick the ones that you need to do most. Figure out where the focus needs to go at what time. And come up with other solutions for the other things. Keyboards and sizes, make sure that if you're in a list view with an adapter, don't redraw all the term cells and things like that that you don't need to redraw, and only redraw the things that you actually need to redraw. And finally, with cursors, tell it to do exactly what you think it should do. If you need to remove it, tell it to remove itself, and you want to add it, tell it to remove itself and then add itself. And with that, we also kind of touched upon focus and cell recycling to give you a pretty broad picture of what all we did to actually make this seemingly simple feature and action actually work at the UI level. If anyone has any questions in specific, obviously please ask me now or please ask me later. And if anyone has ideas of other apps out there that you think have done a really good job of this, we actually try to look a lot at a lot of apps, and you're thinking, oh, there must be ones that have multiple edit texts. A lot of them actually don't allow you to have multiple edit texts, and really they'll have like one text, a bunch of text views and one edit text that, you know, you can click. Anytime you touch a text view, it switches it out and makes it an edit text instead of a text view. But there aren't actually, I don't know of any apps that do what we did here. And if you do, I'd love to hear about them. With that, I am going to wrap up. I have to say we're hiring because we're a startup, and so that's what I'm supposed to say. So we're Quizlet, we're hiring. That's me, Arun Saigal, doing Android stuff, arun@quizlet.com.